Those of who just joined me, again, my name is Albert Yang. I'm going to be the moderator for these sessions called Traffic Operations and Management. And we have actually a total of six speakers. We're going to take a break for 15 minutes, and again, we'll be in this room. For the first part, we have three speakers, and each one will have 20 minutes total, right, including answers and questions. Our first speaker is going to be Sako Hosan from Florida International University. SIDER is a comprehensive framework for traffic incident management program, planning and assessment.
Good morning. Welcome everyone to my presentation. I am Andy Sakhwathusan, PhD student in Florida International University. Today I am going to talk about traffic incident management, which is a major cause for congestion. According to National Traffic Incident Management Coalition, about one quarter of the congestion happens due to traffic incident management. And for each minute of freeway lane blockage, for traffic incident management, it results in 4 minutes of delay even after the incident clearance. So traffic incident management is something that we need to be care about. So the title of my presentation is a comprehensive traffic incident management framework for program planning and assessment. Before getting into the details, I would like to give you the research scope of our project. This is a sponsored project by NCTSPM. At first, we developed a comprehensive framework for traffic incident management program that highlights the key components that are essential to the success of any traffic incident management program, which also outlines the contributing elements that helps to achieve the success of any succeeding elements. And it also serves as a basic guideline in program planning and assessment. We already presented the framework in last year's UTC conference. Also, I will show you. And this presentation focuses on the applicability of the framework in program assessment. And we're using a case study based on FDOT District 14 program. So this is the framework that we proposed last year in Orlando, and I'm going to give you a little idea about what it is. So as you see in the framework, it starts with three broad categories. First, strategic, tactical, and support. And then it expanded with details that are required to achieve the goal for each component. Now, the strategic component focuses on the institutional, organizational, and financial context, while the support component focuses on the communication and information aspects of any team program. And both components are critical to the success of tactical program. which is the core activities of any team program. Now, first take a look about why we are saying our proposed framework would solve or would help any traffic incident management program. So what's the unique in it? It's consistent with the latest regulation that federal guidelines. The framework allows the applicability of any special techniques that are better suited for any specific locales. It follows the hierarchical structure. As you see, there are first tier, second tier, and there are several tiers follows on. The framework is comprehensive. It outlines all key components and elements that needed for success of team program. It's useful at every stage of the team program. As you see in the presentation, it covers and it helps to assess the any existing traffic incident management program. Also, if any agency wants to develop their own incident management program, they can follow the framework. And most important, it's understandable. It intends to leverage an understandable framework that keeps consistent, and it helps both at national and regional level. Now, today's focus is to assess traffic incident management program using our proposed framework. First, I would like to show how strategically District 4 are prepared for their traffic incident management program. I go quickly over their few major activities in the strategic area. One of them is joint operation policy. Why do we need joint operation policy? It's actually because traffic incident management involves multiple stakeholders. It involves law enforcement officer, it involves fire and rescue, FDOT, medical examiner, and so on. So the incident management program is a activities that requires multiple agencies participation. So there needs to be a common operational policy to operate and coordinate between the agencies. The joint operation policy determines what policies agencies should have in place regarding fundamental traffic incident management. Now we cross-checked with our framework and their joint operation policy, and we found out that the following elements of the framework has been covered through their joint operation policy. Now I'm going one by one. It's administrative authorization. In the joint operation policy, they mentioned that FDOT has the authorization over the interstate highway that falls in their district. So it gives the administrative authorization to FDOT. And next, about contracts and agreements, that is element under strategic component. So joint operation policies serve as a standard for other agencies about their procedures, standards. They also mentioned strategic missions and goals, and they facilitate coordinated activities between the agencies. Now, they also have a manual called Incident Response Manual, which is designed to provide uniform guidelines for incident responders. The intent of the Incident Response Manual is to outline primary roles and responsibilities of the various agencies. For example, in case of abandoned hazardous material or in case of any fatal crashes, it outlines what would be the roles and responsibilities for law enforcement officer, for medical examiner, for FDOT, for highway patrol and medical, as I said, and so on. Then again, we cross-checked with our proposed framework and their incident response manual, and we found out the following elements that are covered in incident response manual. They mentioned about response vehicle parking plan, about the placing of response vehicle, duration of response vehicle, roadside usage, traffic lane blockages, etc. They also mentioned when the flashing lights needs to be used, how long it should be in use, the range of the flashing lights, about safety, incident response manual guides, that the responder has to use high visibility safety apparel, which needs to be consistent with American national standard. And lastly, They also said all incident management activities needs to be operated under incident command system. Another major activities of District 4 in strategical area is Memorandum of Understanding, which is intended to provide initial framework and guidelines to promote a collaborative effort. As the team activities involve multiple agencies, so there is often has a chance to get misunderstanding about the roles and responsibility. So the intents of MOU is to clear out what could be the confusions and then come to the agreement between the agencies. The cross-check of the framework find out the following incident management component in District 4 team activities. It gives out the outlines of organizational structure, how the team members of different organizations should be in the team, and they developed several successful MOU with Florida Highway Patrol, with medical examiner, and that MOU ensures regular attendance in the team meetings, which happened monthly, and it also facilitated interagency agreements. Now, open door policy, ABUT has a policy for safe and quick clearance, which is a MOU between Florida Highway Patrol and Florida DOT, that states that all incidents need to be cleared from the roadway within 90 minutes of the arrival of first responding officer. And each ABUT district needs to develop and update their policies to achieve that goal. So after having all these major activities provided by the District 4, we found that still some areas are missing in their team programs, and we recommend the following components that they could major focus on next strategic activities. First, organizational structure. Although they provide an organizational structure, but it's not well defined. Based on their geographic locations, they need to serve district-wide, state-wide, regional, corridor-wide, and national. So their organizational structure needs to be well-defined and cross-linked between which could facilitate multi-agency operations. About the resource identifications, which needs to be automated, which is not we see currently in their program. About reimbursement procedures, we suggest they need to have a separate finance sections which could facilitate reimbursement procedure. And about the improvement procedure, they reference to a task force and feedback committee which could help to identify if the responder fails to operate perfectly, and then they get a message and then they correct their mistakes from the programs, which will eventually help the team program. Now let's take a look about some tactical preparations of the District 4. So some of their major successful program is Road Ranger, Rapid Incident Scene Clearance, and I'm going one by one. About the Road Ranger, each state has something like free highway patrol, and they provide free highway assistance services. Road Ranger is one of the most effective team program of ABUT, and they're fully equipped to handle minor roadside emergencies. They assisted a huge number of customers in 2012. If we compare with any other national road rangers, for example, New York DOT, they have a road ranger like this, and they serve annually around 70,000 people. So it's one of the highest in the nation, and it's a very successful road ranger program of District 4. Next, take a look about Severe Incident Response Vehicle. District 4 launched this program to provide immediate response for severe incident, which lasts more than 2 hours, and it blocks multiple traffic lanes. This acts like an ABUT car spans. They respond 24/7, and they are dispatched by TMC. The members of the SIAB are highly trained uniform incident management specialists, and they carry necessary incident management equipment that are needed for immediate response. As a successful tactical team program of District 4 is Rapid Incident Scene Clearance. which is an incentive-based contract with towing agency. The program is known for its incentive for timely incident clearance, and it also pays reduction in payment for excessive time limit. The program has a clause for times for suspension for hazardous materials or extended cleanup. District 4 has a series of comprehensive online training video for monitoring the on-scene traffic incident management activities. And this training has to be received by each responder that are active in the on-scene field. They followed temporary traffic control procedure, which is developed based on MUTCD, and they applied it for lane control, ramp control, roadway closure, and so on. They also provide detour operations with travel information to the detour traffic and their guidance on the detour road. So these are the main tactical areas that District 4 has, and usually agencies exhibit better performance in tactical component. So as the same thing District 4 has, and we saw that, but still we found that District 4 could have improved in the following areas based on the proposed framework. Right now, they do not have any policy for secondary incident tracking, which is actually a new concept, and the difficulties is associated because the identifying criteria for secondary incident is not clear up to now. Only few DOT has worked on that, and we mentioned here the Oregon DOT policy. They included tracking criteria in their strategic actions, and in the Virginia DOT, they developed a dynamic queue-based identification tool for identifying secondary incident. Now, the last component is support preparations, and they have a major program which is called Interagency Video Event Data Distribution System, which covered almost most of the components in the information and communication aspects. That is actually a web-based application that allows partner agencies to access the roadway information and that distribute light, motion, CCTV camera videos to partner agencies. And the program has been highly acclaimed by FSWA, and they received award for their innovative ideas. And doing this, they also foster relationship with other agencies. So it covers most of the component of support areas, but still we think one major area could be improved is data integration and processing tool. Although the robust ITS infrastructure of District 4 eventually have their TRIM program, but they could still take care of integrating data from different sources, errors with data quality, massive data storage capacity, and automatic data processing. Now our focus is on self-assessment, and if we look at federal guidelines, we see usually agencies are doing well in tactical and support areas and not that much in strategic area. That also we see in their program assessment. They have so many recommendations for strategic area where in tactical and support area they are quite strong. If we see last 3 years' performance of the districts, we see that in most cases the regional performance of District 4 are better than the national average. So after getting all this, we can conclude that the proposed framework serves as an outline for all the key factors that are necessary for a successful program. It provides all the structure details and elements that help achieving the goals of each program component, and it could be useful at every stage of team program, which we see here. From restructuring of a team program or improvement of a team program, or even if it could be a new team program. So now that's all, and I'm happy to answer if you have any questions, or if you have any questions later, you can phone me here.
For a couple of questions.
Thank you. morning, everyone. Most of you in this room have a smartphone, or you'll be getting one in the near future. Today, I'm going to be talking about a smartphone application that passively collects high-resolution travel activity data. To give a brief overview of the presentation, I'm going to start with an introduction, and then I'm going to discuss about the background and motivation for developing this smartphone application. Then I'm going to talk in detail about the Commute Warrior Android app and our ongoing deployment efforts, and finally summarize it state of future work. Traditionally, travel survey data have been collected using two-day travel diaries. But with advances in technology and the decrease in the GPS data logger prices, there are a lot more GPS data collection systems out there. Now, with GPS data loggers, it's possible to collect travel data over longer periods of time, and these longitudinal travel data have a wealth of information. GPS devices can provide accurate and detailed spatial and temporal data, and high-resolution GPS data are very useful in studying travel behavior, driver behavior, safety, emissions, etc. Now, multiple studies have shown that there are significant underreporting for travel diary trips, something in the range of 25 to 30%, and this could affect any modeling or behavior studies using these data. For example, the Commute Atlanta study, which is an instrumented vehicle study, did a two-day travel diary of its participants, and these are the results of the study. 29% of GPS vehicle trips were not reported in the diaries. The average number of trips per day from the diary was 5.9 versus 8.4 from the devices. The underreporting of the vehicle miles traveled was 22%. And this underreporting was not random. It looks like, from the study, they found that the short distance and short duration trips were missed. People forgot to report the trips at the end of the day. And some households had a lot more underreporting than other households, and that influenced the demographic balance of the travel diary data. Now, GPS data loggers, while they're very good at collecting data, if there is any interaction that is required with the users, they are also likely to suffer from underreporting. In 2013, there was a study done in UK and Australia with 19 participants where they used GPS data loggers that required interaction with the user and a sense cam to get the ground truth, and they found 21.5% of the total trips were missed. So, for a good travel data collection system, it's important that it is passive and requires minimal interaction with the participant. Nielsen, which tracks mobile usage statistics, said in 2013 that 64% of all mobile users had a smartphone, and 80% of all new phone purchases were a smartphone. Now, smartphones have built-in GPS, they have good processing power, they have communication such as wireless networks as well as Wi-Fi communications. And most importantly, anybody who has a smartphone will vouch for it, that people almost carry their smartphone pretty much wherever they go. So a travel data collection system using these smartphones is going to be a very efficient, it's a very efficient device to use for building a system. Now, one concern that is always in the back of all smartphone users is battery consumption. So we need to keep that in mind while building any system. So if you were to build a travel data collection system on a smartphone, these would be the objectives of the system. The first is there should be minimal user interaction so that we don't lose any data. There should be a battery saving mode to make sure that the users don't feel that the application is like draining their battery. We want to give the users the ability to protect their privacy if they desire so. And for a research perspective, we are interested in getting real-time and second-by-second or high-resolution data for the research. And we also need to have the ability for the users to review their trips and provide us feedback in forms of survey for more detailed analysis. And with that in mind, we built the Commute Warrior Android application. So the Commute Warrior is an Android app that tracks your personal cell phone. So it's important to understand that it's tracking the cell phone, and the assumption here is the users almost always carry their cell phone, and thereby we are tracking them. The app monitors second by second phone location and speed while you're making a trip. and it has the ability to transmit data in real time back to the server through the wireless communications, or if the user has concerns about their data plans and the bandwidth usage, they can always store the data in the device and upload it when they connect to a Wi-Fi. The app integrates the functionality of previous vehicle tracking systems, including travel diary reporting. The app runs in the background with low battery power draw. So this is how the app looks on your home screen. If you look on the top of the status bar, you can see that the small icon there says that the app is running in the background. It's always on. You can stop, the participant can stop recording the data anytime by going to the menu if they want to protect their privacy. You also have a widget which essentially provides information about the status of the app, and it also shows data collection and transmission activity. So the first time you install the app, you're going to have a consent agreement presented in front of you where you consent to share your travel data with us. And once you agree to it, we go to the login screen. On the login screen, a login is required to record data, access data, view your trips, record travel diary data, and basically once you log in is when the app really starts tracking your data. Each login is associated with a smartphone, and we have noticed that people do change their phones in the middle of a study, and especially if you're going to collect this data over longer periods of time, people might change devices, and it's better that we link all the devices back to a single account so that we can keep track of all travel activity by that individual. So this is the main interface page that is displayed after the login, and this is what you would normally see when you like open the app. So the first is the settings icon, followed by the button that takes you to the travel journal page. The next button is the stop recording button, which provides lets you stop all kind of tracking if you want to protect your privacy. And the last button is the hide window button, which essentially like pushes the app to run in the background. The interesting thing is, even if you restart your phone, the app restarts automatically and it runs in the background. Let's say if you hit the settings button, you're going to be presented with these settings. The first is how you want to run the app. If people choose to run the app only when it's connected to an external power source, they could do that. Or you could just run the battery, like either on battery or external power source. You could set the minimum battery level beyond which you don't want the app to track any more data and use any more battery power. So people have the ability to conserve battery once the battery level comes below that level. We also have the option for the user to select whether data can be uploaded via cellular or only through Wi-Fi. We have a logout screen that will de-link your account with the device from that day forward. And finally, you can hit the stop recording and the exit, which stops the application and closes it. If you were to select the travel journal button, this is where you go. You are presented with a calendar where each day on which we have travel monitored is highlighted in green. Now you have the ability to navigate between back and forward on the different months to see your past travel history. And each date links to the particular trip journal for that day. So if you were to select a day, you would look at all the trips made on that day. First you have the map icon that is useful for you to like look at your trip on a map. We have the start date, the start time and the duration in minutes and the distance in miles. And finally, we have a survey icon that lets you enter your trip purpose data. So if you were to look at the map, click on the map icon, you're going to go to a page where it shows your entire trip. The red flag indicates your end of the trip, and the green flag is the start of the trip. The map has pan, zoom, center, auto center, slider bar functionality. So as soon as you load the map, it starts the trip playback animation, which helps you visualize your trip speed and delays. It's pretty interesting to see. And going back to the trip journal page, and if you were to select the survey icon, you're going to present it with a small survey where you can provide us feedback on the primary and secondary trip purpose. We also have a web interface that supports the long form of the diary with more complex nested options such as business types, route information, passengers, etc. This is actually the long form web interface. So on the first page, you can actually show the map and ask you for the primary trip purpose. And based on what you select, we provide a list of detailed sub questions for you to answer and for us to get a lot more information about the trip. Coming back to the app itself, the app has the ability for researchers can send travel diary requests for particular desired dates. It could be dates on which there are special events, or if the researchers find that there is a interesting event on a particular day, we could ask request for more survey through the server and for more detailed information. The server can also be programmed to automatically request travel diary. Like, we could program it to say, like, every Monday, you know, send a travel diary request, or say, like, select 7 random days out of a month and then request for travel diary. So with that, coming to our ongoing deployment efforts, right now we are beta testing the app within our department, and we are targeting 40 participants who will continue with whom we'll do all our beta version of the apps as we improve it. And for our initial field deployment, we are right now pursuing targeting 80 participants along the I-85 HOT corridor. Greta and SETA have been our regional deployment partners, with Greta helping publicizing our app through their Express Bus Rider newsletter and their blog site. And if you're interested in participating, anyone can participate. You need to visit our website at transportation.ce.gatec.edu/commutewarrior to learn more about the app and how to sign up for it. Or you can contact us at commutewarrior@ce.gatec.edu. So to summarize, we have created an app that has minimal user interaction. The only thing that you really need to do is give consent to our sharing our data with us, and then log in. And that's it, the app tracks all your activity. We have the ability to protect your privacy if you choose to mask a particular trip. The app has marginal impact on smartphone battery life based on real life use. App is very efficient in collecting all modes of travel. Since January 1st, we had about 12 people testing the app, and we have collected more than 4,300 trips, and we have monitored more than 10,000 miles of travel. The Commutewarrior Android app is now available, and currently we are beta testing it via the Google groups. And we are planning to put the app on the public Play Store by the end of this month, that is within the next 1 week. And we are planning to deploy 200 units in spring 2014, and over fall and over summer and fall, we are hoping to recruit another 1,000 people along the I-85 HOT lane commuter shed. We are hoping to learn about the HOT lane use behavior among these participants. We are also proposing to add a travel mode question to the survey, both on the app as well as on the website. We are also working on adding health measures functionality to the app, where we could provide feedback on the number of calories burnt in a walk trip or number of steps taken by the user. And finally, iPhones are about 40% of the smartphones in the US, and so we are also trying to build this app for the iOS operating system, and hopefully we'll have it out in the summer of 2014. With that, I'm going to open to the questions, and you can actually, while we do that, you can see the visualization of my flight to Atlanta on Saturday. Just a part of the trip. This is how it looks on the app.
Question? Vetri, do you have an option of limiting it to a particular class of trips, like a home to work trip or something, or is that a future application?
So we cannot limit that in the sense when you collect data, we do not know at the beginning of a trip whether it's going to be a home to work trip, unless the user says it's going to be a home to work trip. So that if we were to do that, we'll have to remove the passive part of the data collection part, then it becomes an interactive data collection part.
Well, you can do it by origin destination.
That is, we'll know that only after we collect the data. So of course, we will be able to identify home and work trips after we collect the data, because we will have a sufficient travel history, and we can do a survey to verify their home and work locations, or even you can identify by heuristic analysis, and we will have the ability to plot test those trips.
We do have the ability to work on the server side to geofence an OD pair and only retain those data, but until we get it on the app side, we have to do it on the server.
With respect to incentives for the users, not necessarily financial incentive, but will they get something out of this? Obviously, you want a lot of people to use this. What would be the motivation for them to download this app?
Right. That's a good question that we have been asking ourselves. So the first thing that we noticed is, we did a study with the University of Minnesota where that was like about 3-4 years back where we collected the data and did an online travel diary survey, and we had about 90% of responses to the online travel diary survey. So what we found from that study was people are interested in like looking at their travel patterns, if presented in a nice way. And that anybody, like, you know, for our participants itself, when they see the app and they interact with it and they kind of like to come back and look at their trips. So that is one of the benefits that we're offering right now. And from my own personal experience, like, you know, a couple of months back I went to a restaurant, I forgot the name of the restaurant, but I remembered the date I went. I just went back to my trip, opened up the map and saw where it was, and then I figured out which restaurant it was. So then, I mean, like, that, those benefits are there, but hopefully, like, you know, as we go forward, when we integrate the health measure benefits to the app and where we can provide the calories burnt and number of steps they have taken and things like that, I think the users, the participants might find the app to be useful to one more, and that would be the incentive for them.
I'll just ask one. This seems like a challenging IRB when you start digging into some of these things. Is there anything you've done to try to limit that side of it? And also, did you have cellular service on when you were flying in your airplane?
Well, FAA has approved use of cell phones in airplane mode, and I can store the data on my device and upload it once I land. So it is legal. So yes, I mean, privacy is a big part of what we do, and it's a major concern. So we have got permission from IRB, like making our server secure and our system secure. And going forward, like, it's always a concern, and we are all about protecting our data. And in fact, like, we don't publish the raw data outside of our secure lab. Anybody who's interested in looking at the data have to be in our lab. We do not.
Ask people to come back and manually enter.
No, we do not. If they have masked the trip for privacy concerns, we have no business getting it. Well, we have no business getting information on them. I mean, we can make a guess. We can make an educated guess on the origin and destination based on the previous trip and the after trip. But if they said, let's say they did 2 or 3 trips, we have no idea of what they did during that time.
Thank you. Our next speaker before we take a break is Somaya from Sharing. She is from Florida International University.
My name is Somaya. I'm a PhD student from Florida International University. My presentation is QLA's estimation based on point detector data and AVI data automatic vehicle identification. As you see, my project is conducted with Florida International University and UCF, University of Central Florida, with Dr. Mohammed Hadi as my advisor, Dr. Ali, and first of all, you see my content in this presentation. First, I want to introduce my background, and then detector and AVI data, then methods, and the case study one is TenPy in Florida, and case study two in SRA-26. At first, in the background of this project, the framework in this project was presented in Orlando last year in UTC. The first part was in comparison between experience travel time versus instantaneous travel time. That published and presented at TRB conference. Now I want to present the second part, is the Q-length estimation based on detector data and AVI data, and the future work is estimation of density. In this project, we have several approaches that was based on detectors, upstream and downstream detectors, and AVI measurement, and then cumulative volume. The case study one was 10 pipe with this length of 1.8 miles, and the case study two is SR826 with 0.94 miles, but the detector, the upstream and downstream detector, the length of the detector is 0.3. Our method for Q-length estimation was based on detector and AVI. For detector itself, as all of you know, we can calculate the Q based on speed and based on volume. For the speed, we can find out the fully congested, partial congested, or totally uncongested. For volume based, as a Q theory, is arrival vehicles more than departure vehicles. For AVI, we can calculate Q length only based on speed for fully congested or fully uncongested. But the problem for AVI data is that we don't have, because we don't like detector, we don't have upstream and downstream detectors. We cannot find out the partial Q based on AVI data. But in our research, we combine detector data and AVI data to find out Q. The combination between AVI data and detector data. As you see, our method was based on speed and based on travel time. Based on speed, if both detector, upstream and downstream detectors, less than speed threshold, in our research, the threshold speed is 40 miles per hour. If both detector is less than 40, we can find out that the length is totally congested. Both detector more than 40 is totally uncongested, and we know the average speed from AVI data, and we combine the speed between detector data and AVI data. As well for travel time based, we know the travel time based on AVI and travel time based on detector, and we find out the Q length based on travel time. The method that I mentioned, Q-length estimation, the detector itself, AVI itself, and the combination between AVI and detector data. For case study one, is 10 pipe with the length of 1.8. As you see, based on type data, AVI data is the blue one, and we know only fully congested and fully uncongested, but for the detector data, the red one, we know the partial Q. We assume that if one of the detectors is less than 40, the partial Q is half of the. With the combination method, as you see, the yellow one and purple one, based on speed and based on travel time, we find out the partial Q during congestion time. For cumulative volume, all of you know that arrival vehicle is more than departure vehicles. The distance between the number of the arrival vehicles and departure vehicles is the Q. Arrival volume versus the departure volume, not the cumulative. For case study two was SR826, and this is for only based on simulation. We have a simulation. For the case study two, SR826, we have two data, from the real world data and simulation data. For simulation data, for find out the speed threshold, we calculated Q length, speed 30, 35, and 40, and we considered 40 mile per hour as a speed threshold. For case study two, as I mentioned before, we have like turnpike data, we have a real world data from tag data and detector data, and simulation. And simulation is based on speed trajectory. Like turnpike data, this is from detector, tag, travel time based speed. As you see, for totally congested and totally uncongested, there's no big difference between AVI data and detector data, but for the partial queue, because we don't have any information from AVI data for partial queue, because we don't have upstream and downstream like detectors, we combine detector and AVI and we calculated the queue. This is the comparison between simulation data and real world data. The detector time, travel time based, and the speed based is as a real world data, and trajectory data is as a blue one. And as you see, there is no so close to real world data or simulation data. For conclusion, the most important thing is this project is the accuracy of AVI data, because AVI data, automatic vehicle identification, is a state of the art technology like Bluetooth data, tag data, GPS data. In this project, we want to find out which one is better, because we know about the accuracy of detector data. But for the AVI data itself, we want to find out is it accurate or not. But in this part, we found out that the combination between AVI data and detector data is a very good result, and we can trust to AVI data. For Q-Lane, AVI data itself doesn't have good result, but in future work, we are working on density estimation. For density, the AVI data is a very good result, and we are working to find out why for Q, theory and queue length, there's no good result for AVI, but for density is a very good result. If you have any question,
again. So we are doing very well with time. I guess we have time for 5 questions.
One thing about the queue length. So how do you define queue length? Is it the number of vehicles at a certain road segment?
For cumulative volume, yes, the number of vehicles. But for the detector data, because we have a length of the segment, and as I mentioned, we know that the length of the between upstream detector and downstream detector, for example, for turnpike or another case study, is 1.8 miles. If totally, if both detector is less than the speed threshold, it means that it's totally congested. So the queue length is 1.8. If both detector is more than 40, it's totally uncongested. So the queue length is 0 mile. No, the queue length for the based on the length segment is based on mile, not the number of vehicles. But for cumulative volume, it's based on number of vehicles.
And when you talk about arrivals and departures, those are the vehicles arriving and departing to that particular road segment? Is that what you're looking at when you talk about arrivals versus departures?
Yes, for the volume, the number of vehicles arriving in the segment, and if the, the arrival vehicles is more than the departure vehicle and the current vehicle, we know that the how many vehicles are in the queue. It's as a queue length.
Take a break and finance again at 10:45, not 9:45.